the fun part. I'd like to introduce you to you our speaker, Rob Lilwall. So he's someone who has trekked over 80,000 kilometers of land across the world, including the most desolate and treacherous places like the Gobi Desert in Afghanistan. So please help to welcome Rob as he gives us his take on survival.
Great, thank you so much, Diana, for that kind introduction. So, my name's Rob, I'm originally from London, and when I left university about 15 years ago, my first job, proper job, was a geography high school teacher. So I was teaching children all about the world, about the distant mountains and rivers and cities of our planet. But after I'd been teaching for a couple of years, I decided I wanted to go and explore the world firsthand. And so I thought, I'm going to go and travel across the world on a bicycle. So I took my bicycle, but rather than setting off from England, I thought it would be more fun if I started as far away from home as possible. So I bought a one-way plane ticket and I flew all the way across the world to northeast Russia, to a small old gulag city called Magadan. And then I spent the following 3 years cycling back again. I went through about 28 countries, had all sorts of kind of pretty crazy out of my depth adventures along the way. That's Siberia at about minus 40, crossing a river. And I should just say right off the bat, in case you haven't noticed, I am a very ordinary looking guy. I'm not very tough looking, and that reason is I'm not very tough. I am very ordinary, geography teacher, I was also quite a fearful person. I got frightened of things quite easily. I was the kid in class when I was at school who never put his hand up. Then when I was a teacher, I was that teacher who was afraid of his kids. So I was a pretty fearful guy. But I found on this journey, I learned so much and I really grew up. And as I reflect back on it now, I think maybe the reason I did this was I didn't want to be the sort of person whose life was determined by the things I was afraid of. I wanted to face my fears and somehow gradually learn to overcome them. So I survived that trip, got back to London. Actually, the best thing that happened on that trip by far was something that happened here in Hong Kong. I met a beautiful girl, and then when I got back to London, I married her. So I met my wife on the way. And then a sort of, not nearly as good as that, was that I suddenly got this new career as an adventurer, which I didn't go looking for. I just, National Geographic got in touch and bought my film footage off me, and a publisher got in touch, so I wrote my first book. And suddenly, I became this kind of part-time professional adventurer. And me and Christine moved to Hong Kong. We've been here about 7 years now. And I've done various other adventures over the last decade or so, a little bit in the Middle East, a lot in Asia. And that brings me to today's story, which starts about a year ago. Here in Hong Kong, I was thinking, it's time to do another adventure. I hadn't done one for a year or two, and I was thinking, it's time to do another adventure. And I started looking at my map of China. I love China. It's kind of one of the kind of great places to still go really exploring. And as I looked around China, and I've been like around here, I've been to Tibet and most of this bit, and then my eyes kind of drifted west. And I don't know if you've ever noticed, have you ever noticed this? Anyone ever spotted that when you look at a map of China? That's like, you know, it's like bigger than Thailand, and it's just empty, this massive empty bit. Anyone know the name of that desert? Not the Gobi, it's the Taklamakan. I think I heard somebody say Gobi's up here. It's this big kind of gravelly flat one up here. This is it's the second biggest sandy desert in the world. It's called the Taklamakan. I thought, oh, that looks interesting. And I'd heard of it, but I didn't know much about it. Started Googling, saw some more map. That's the sort of close-up map. It's about 1,000 kilometers across. And now as I Googled it, I found out some interesting things. The Taklamakan Desert, it's got some other alternative names. Sometimes it's called the Desert of Death. That's quite interesting. Sometimes it's translated as He Who Goes In Won't Come Out. And the Silk Road comes along here from Siam, splits. It can't go through the middle. So the Northern Silk Road, Southern Silk Road. And Marco Polo travelled the Southern Silk Road about 800 years ago. And he talked about travellers on the Silk Road would hear these mysterious songs coming out of the desert, and they'd be lured off the path and they'd never be seen again. So kind of ominous desert, but I thought, oh, kind of intriguing. And I asked a friend, an adventurer friend, oh, do you know, has anybody sort of explored this much? And he said, there's a book about it, the only team who's ever crossed it. It's by this ex-military guy called Charles Blackmore, who back in the mid-1990s took a team of 15 people and 30 camels. They crossed it from west to east, took them about 2 months. And so I thought, okay, I ordered the book off Amazon, I read it, and it was quite a good book. I mean, it's all about these guys, they had all these camels, and you can see these aren't, it's not just like flat sand, it's like massive sand dunes. And I found myself, as I read it, even though it sounded completely crazy, I started scribbling notes and highlighting and thinking, oh, maybe I could try and do it. And I thought, well, nobody's ever crossed this, only one team has ever crossed it, Charles's team, and nobody's ever crossed it solo. Am I mad enough to try and cross it solo? And then I thought, but I don't know anything about camels. Camel, you know, and it sounds like camels, they always bite you and spit at you and run off, and generally they're a real pain in the neck. So I thought, I don't want to take camels. Maybe I can do what like people do when they go to the South Pole. That's not me, that's just off the internet. But you know, they drag all their stuff in a sled. And I thought, maybe I can just drag all my stuff in a sled across the desert. And it seemed like a completely crazy plan. I did a bit more research and it just seemed crazier and crazier. And I was kind of looking for an excuse not to do it because it sounded too crazy, but I couldn't get the idea out of my head. And I thought, I have to talk to somebody who's a real expert on this desert. Who can I talk to who really knows about, who could it be? And I thought, it's gotta be Charles. So I found Charles on LinkedIn. He runs a risk consultancy in London, and I was back in London for some work. And so I emailed him and we met up for a coffee. And I we sat down for this coffee, and I thought, I'm going to explain the plan, the sled, the solo, and he's going to say, Rob, it's a terrible plan, you'll die, don't do it. You know, then I'll have an honourable excuse not to do it. And I explained it to him, and then he said, Rob, it's a brilliant plan, you've got to do it. And I said, what? And he said, yeah, you've got to do it. And I said, I'm thinking about it. I'm going to think about it for a while. Maybe I'll try and do it in 2017. So it gives me, this is about a year. It gives me a year and a bit to plan it. And he said, nope, if you wait till 2017, you'll never do it. It's now or never. You've got to do it autumn 2016. Autumn's the time for this desert. So I thought, okay. And a couple of days later, I wasn't in London for long, but we got back to Hong Kong, and me and Christine were talking about it. My wife, Christine, we were talking about it. And we were sort of like, oh, I don't know. And then we found out Christine was pregnant, and we'd been wanting to have children for ages, and suddenly we were going to have children due in December, a baby due in December, and we thought, well, can't do it once the baby arrives, it's now or never, you've got to go for it. So I thought, okay, let's start planning. So first thing to do, I ordered a sled off Amazon, and Christine sat on it. That's Mui Wo. Who's from Mui Wo here? I've seen a few Mui Wo. A few Mui Wo friends here. We walked up and down Mui Wo Beach about twice with Christine sitting on it, and very quickly I realised this was a terrible plan. I could barely make it once up the beach and I was exhausted. So then we did some more research and we found these wheels called wheelies online, which are these kind of balloon type, these balloon tires, for basically Americans going, no offence to Americans, but Americans love picnics on the beach with loads and loads of food, and they have these kind of carts of these wheels, so they can get over the sand. So we ordered some of these wheels which work on sand, and we found Gary, who is Christine's cousin's boyfriend, he knew Mr. Look, who was a welder in Kowloon. So he built us a cart, with the sled on it, there are the wheels. And then we had to test it again, so I went back to Mui Wo Beach, and people on in Mui Wo, I think, thought I was a bit mad. I bumped into my friend Paul on the ferry this morning, who lives in Mui Wo, and he said to me, we don't see each other very often, he said, Rob, was that you last year walking up and down the beach with a sled? And I was like, yeah, that was me. And so I was walking up and down the beach with this cart, and I needed more weight on it, and all these children kept asking me what I was doing, so I said, just get on. And so I walked up and down the beach training with weights, and it worked. It was amazing. It worked. And so I had a cart. And so maybe the plan was feasible. I also had to get fit. Getting fit, I was 39 years old, so I wasn't like young enough to be injury proof. So it wasn't just getting fit, it was also learning how to be injury proof. So I went to see Andrew, who's a very cool physio here in Hong Kong, who taught me how to roll. Has anyone done that where you roll on a bit of foam? Kind of like, sort of self-massage, and it's really brilliant for injury prevention. So I got kind of fit, injury proof, and also I should explain, the plan wasn't to try and carry 2 months worth of water with me, because clearly that wouldn't be possible, but there are, these days, this is what made this trip possible, they've discovered oil in the desert. So now there's three main oil roads running north to south. My plan was to go east to west, and I decided I can't carry everything. I'm gonna drive around the week before I set off, and I'm gonna plant caches, or supply dumps of food and water at these various places. So I won't be carrying everything, I'll be going kind of from supply dump to supply dump. And the first, I knew on the edge of the desert, this is the first 100 and something kilometers, there's a lot of vegetation, so I knew I couldn't take the cart because the vegetation would puncture the wheels. So I actually hid the cart here, and so for the first week or two, I was walking with just a rucksack. So that was the plan. And so then, feeling incredibly nervous, said goodbye to Christine, and I had to do it. I ended up having to start in August because it was kind of various things meant I had to start in August, super hot, and I set off across the gravel plains at the edge of the Taklamakan, feeling super nervous, thinking, I can't, have you ever done that when you've been dreaming about a project for a while and then the day it starts arrives and you're like, I cannot believe I'm actually doing this mad, mad thing. And but it was time to go, and it was super, super hot, and so I, luckily I had an umbrella, so I just have to hide under that. But even after the first day, I was just feeling utterly parched. It was about 40 degrees. And on the second day, I started getting blisters. So like blisters on my hips from the rucksack, blisters on my feet. And then as I kept going to work, these sort of farms on the edge of the desert, which were being irrigated by rivers from the Himalayas. And so I ended up getting lost in these farms. It was very swampy. And it was just really, really kind of a difficult start to the trip. About 4 days in, I was like, 4 days in, I've got another 2 months of this. How on earth am I going to do it? I'm already exhausted. And I think something that really helps us, we all know about them, but I don't think we often utilize them enough in normal life. Something that really helps us is just simply being clear about our goals. And I had such a burning clear goal. I was trying to get here, but it wasn't just one big goal. I'd broken it up into lots of little goals. So instead of thinking about the big goal, I thought, right, all I'm gonna do is just get to that next cash, get to that next cash. And it's so much easier psychologically when we just focus on the next thing. And I think goals also help us in other ways. The other day I saw a documentary about Warren Buffett, and there's this bit where he meets Bill Gates and they become good friends. And someone makes them sit down when they've only recently got to know each other, and without conferring, write down on a piece of paper one word, which is the secret of their success. Both wrote the same word, which was focus. I thought that was really interesting. I think goals help us have focus. So I kept on going, and then often if you keep going, things get easier again. And I met this guy who was collecting melons from the farms. He was from near Beijing, and he said he'd driven all the way there from Beijing. And I said, wow, where are you going? And he said, Guangdong. So he was going this massive lap of China with his melons, and he said, have a melon. So I had a melon. And so I felt a lot better. And one night I went, and the other thing that goals give us, I think, is courage. And I now encountered my first big obstacle, which George, I feel like the microphone battery's dying. Is that one going to try that? If not, I will use my teacher voice. I was going to encounter this river, which I thought, a river on the edge of the desert can't be too deep or too wide. and I thought I'd just wade across it. I thought maybe it'll be up to my waist. But I got to this river, and I'm going to show you a video clip, and I saw it definitely wasn't just waist deep, and it definitely wasn't slow flowing. And luckily I had lots of empty water bottles with me, from the water I was drinking. So I ended up using these to kind of help my rucksack and all my heavy gear to float. And I would have to kind of shuttle backwards and forwards with my heavy stuff. So I'll show you this video, but just again, that point about goals, I think if I hadn't been crystal clear about my goal, I wouldn't have had the courage even to get over this obstacle at the beginning.
Well, I'm in a real dilemma here. The river is more flooded than I thought. I should have taken a better look at it when I had the chance. I think I probably can swim across it, but whether I can get all my stuff across without losing some of it is another question. Yeah, I really hope I don't drown. Kind of scary and exhilarating and exhausting. But I don't need to float my things across, I don't think. I think I can just maybe take the rucksack across in three different batches.
I ended up having to swim across that river 12 times to get all my gear across. I got across very happy, over the first big obstacle, and then I got to my cart. And I've been thinking, what name? I need a good name. You know, it's kind of my only companion. Odysseus. It was a good name for a cart. So me and Odysseus, we loaded up, and I set off now deep into the desert. And now I was really heading away from any roads and things. And at first it was okay, kind of, it wasn't too hilly. There were a few trees around. And I started to learn quite quickly as it got a bit more dunes, kind of how to go up. You can kind of contour your way up. And then sometimes I'd just let Odysseus go and I'd have to run after him before he capsized to go down. And gradually made progress. Started to get a few punctures because there were a few sort of bits of vegetation. I had to learn how to fix those, and gradually the dunes got bigger and they got steeper, and I'd kind of get over on top of one dune, which was hard work, and then I'd look out and there were lots more, and it just went on like that for about the next 800 kilometers of dunes. So this was pretty intimidating, but I kept going forwards, and you can see me there sort of on my hands and knees just kind of climbing up one of the really big ones, and then on about the fourth day going into the deep dunes, one day I was going up a really steep dune, and it was kind of 4 PM, so it was still pretty hot, and suddenly my head was like spinning, and my knees started to buckle, and I just sat down in the sand, and I was utterly kind of spent. I just couldn't move, let alone pull the cart up, and I took a little bit of a break. My water, I was just about on schedule with water, but I was slipping behind schedule in terms of my daily distances. And obviously I had to stay on track to get to my next stash of supplies. I started to panic. I ended up not traveling any further that day because I just thought I need to have a break. And it felt like mild heat stroke, I suppose, I was getting. And heat stroke, it's not really a problem on the beach, but if you get it on your own in the desert, it's a major problem because you lose your judgment. If you lose your judgment out there on your own, it's really, really dangerous. And so I was really freaked out. And I realized I had to look after myself better. So the next morning, actually, I was trying to go. I was about here now, so heading into the deep desert. And I was trying to get to my next supplies here. And fortunately, the next morning, I saw, if I headed south a little bit, just about 10 kilometers, the dunes got a lot smaller. And even though it would be a longer route round, I could kind of walk round and then join this road here and then head up to my cache. And so that's what I did. Thankfully, it worked. And I kind of got back on track with the smaller dunes. But from that point on, I realized I really have to look after myself. There's no point pushing yourself so hard that you collapse. So then I started, in the middle of the day, I started to take a siesta between, you know, 1 and 3, just to get out of the sun, and then I'd drink less water, and really, really thinking, how can I look after myself? And I think it's totally the same situation. Our theme is survival today. It's totally the same situation in the corporate world or the creative world, where we can push ourselves too hard, and it's super counterproductive. You know, the 40-hour work week? Do you know who came up with that? It was Henry Ford. He was Mr. Efficiency. And he worked out his workers could only work 40 hours a week. And beyond that, it became more and more inefficient. So 40 hours, they actually got more work than if they did 50 hours on top. So I think so often we work too hard, counterproductive. We don't look after ourselves. We need to take more siestas, maybe, or something like that. And it really is relevant to everything. And I got to my next cache. And so that was good. I was on track. And then I went back into the deeper desert. You can see there, kind of on my own, going deep, deep, deep through the dunes. And it was actually a really, really beautiful experience. I think, again, silence is something we almost completely lack in Hong Kong. And it's such a magical thing. I didn't have cell reception for about 8 days at this point. It was so amazing. I did have a satellite texting device, so I could send text messages to my wife, but no emails or anything like that. And it was just amazing being on my own, lovely, kind of almost like a healing experience, just to have that peace and quiet. And I started to really feel I was getting the hang of it. I was now almost halfway. It had been tough, but I was kind of on track, approaching my next big cache of supplies. And then I got to the next cache spot, and it had disappeared. I'd hidden it next to the road, and I realised there were some road workers, road repair workers, and they had found it and taken it. And I'd left it there about 6 weeks before, so I don't blame them. But this was a problem. But like most problems, there was a kind of way forward. So I ended up hiding the cart, and I was by an oil road. So I hitchhiked down the road. I was here, this is where the cab, this big cab. I hitchhiked about 70 kilometres down the road to Nia. I bought a load of supplies, threw them in the back of a taxi. At the taxi, we started to drive back into the desert. Unfortunately, at that point, the police saw me and stopped us. And I was trying to explain, I'm just looking at the desert, basically. this trip, it wasn't illegal. I wasn't doing anything illegal, but let's just say I didn't ask permission to do it, because if I'd asked permission, the Chinese authorities would have said no. And so, anyway, the police let us go, so that was good. And then the next day, I started heading onwards now into the deep, deep desert here. And then it was kind of on track. Then about mid-morning, I looked around, and I was surrounded by policemen. And what I realised had happened was the police had told the taxi driver, tell us where you drop him off. And then the next morning they sent out a team, basically, to catch me. And I was kind of, you know, I couldn't escape, not with my heavy cart. And so the local police chief turned up, and he said, you can't go into the desert. And I said, no, I'm not doing any harm. But he was basically worried I would die, and if I died, he would get in trouble. And he was very, very nice about it, but he wouldn't let me go. And he said, no, I'm going to drive you out of my jurisdiction, and then you're not my problem. So he drove me. We actually had a convoy. That was the route I was trying to do across. We were here, trying to go across there. But he drove me down this road, through his town, dropped me the other side of the river on the Southern Silk Road. And to be honest, that was me the next morning when I got up camping beside this road. I was utterly devastated. I'd just spent, you know, 6 weeks going through a very tough expedition. It was all on track, and kind of just like that, I'd been kind of a little bit of carelessness, but mostly bad luck. I'd been caught, and I'd been forced to drive, so my kind of line of footprints had been broken. Now I wasn't even in the deep desert. I was right on the edge of the desert, and I thought, the expedition is ruined. My plan of going through the middle, first solo crossing of the desert, it's been ruined. I've got a broken line of 80 kilometers where I was forced into a car, and my footprints aren't even connected. Even if I keep going on the Southern Silk Road, I've got this gap. And I felt so devastated. But rather than just sitting around, when we suffer a setback, I think there are a few things which are helpful on an expedition. First of all, if you can, just kind of keep moving, because that's better than sitting around. So I got up, I started walking along the Silk Road. Another thing that's helpful, I sent a message, I now had mobile reception, sent a text message to my 5 best friends and asked them all, can you call me? And some of them were adventurers, some of them weren't. And all 5 of them, a great kind of credit to the friendship, they all phoned me up that day in the middle of China, and I had great conversations, and they gave me ideas, they encouraged me. One friend said, you know, just make an even cooler plan for the second half. You know, this is where you are now, forget about what happened, just make an even better plan. So I got some great advice, and it's interesting, social support networks, the positive psychologists in America have seen that social support networks are probably more important than IQ for career success. Having groups of people around you who can encourage us, who kind of mentor us, and so it's so important we invest not just in our work relationships, our social relationships. And then the other thing that helped me was something my wife said to me, and she said, look, your plan A hasn't worked, but you were trying your best. And that is really the most important thing. And the important thing is now you get up tomorrow and you try your best again. And then the day after you try your best. And for some reason, I know that's a kind of kindergarten sort of lesson, but it just really sunk in. Yeah, I've been really trying my best. The important thing is I'm going to try my best every day, despite that setback. If I do my best every day for the rest of the expedition, maybe it can still succeed somehow. So I kept on going. I had a nice time walking by the Silk Road for about a week. Fires, I saw some camels on the edge of the desert. And then I found a route back into the desert on another oil road. So I wasn't able to go straight back in because it just wasn't possible to go back into the desert at first. But I found a road back in. And then, this is the orange line I took on the road. And then I was heading back into the proper desert here. And along the Mazatag line, this kind of weird line of mountains in the middle of the desert. But there were oil trucks, there were oil exploration trucks, and I'd learned my lesson, don't get seen, because if you get seen, they'll catch you and they'll throw you out of the desert. So I got very paranoid and I started kind of camping during the day and hiding in the day and then walking at night.
I've been walking for about 45 minutes in the dark. I've got probably an 8-hour night walk to do 35 kilometres, which it's not that far, but it's quite hard work at night. And I just saw some headlights coming down the road. I can hear the cars getting nearer, so I've got off the road. I'm hiding.
All right, guys.
Right, James Bond. I'm not James Bond at all. Time to get back on the road.
So I got a little bit mad in my kind of solitude. But I gradually made progress and things were kind of falling apart a bit. The cart, Odysseus's wheels, called the bearings, had broken, so he was sort of stumbling along. My shoes started to fall apart. I had this giant rip down the back of my trousers. And really, really kind of falling to pieces, but the end was almost in sight, heading for that final goal now. And then I came across this little oil track. And I thought, wow, the desert is almost over. Where is the desert actually finished? How do you mark the end of a desert? And I saw some trees, I thought maybe. But I kept going, and then I got to a shepherd's stream. And so I just ran into this stream and just kind of finished. And I was so happy. And yet I still felt, I'd ended up finishing about a week early because I'd had to go on that road. It sort of speeded me up. I thought, oh, I've done my best. Is there anything I can do about that bit I missed? And I thought, well, I've got a week before my plane ticket. So I ended up, I dumped Odysseus on the edge of the desert by a Chinese factory. And then I hitchhiked, I finished around here. I hitchhiked down this road all the way about 1,000 kilometers, all the way along to where the police had dropped me off here. And I thought, well, maybe if I walk this bit that I missed, but backwards, it's the last thing they'll expect is me coming from the other direction. And now I've just got a rucksack. It's much easier to hide with a rucksack than with a cart. I just had 3 days of water I could carry. And so I managed to walk this final bit up there and got to the bit where the police had caught me. So I kind of managed to join those footprints and flew home. And so, thank you. The question question I want to kind of leave. Well, I've talked about a few reflections on survival, and you know, we don't just want to survive, we want to thrive, don't we? It's kind of two sides of the same coin. We've talked a bit about goals, which we all know about, but I think we forget to kind of be clear about them sometimes. We've talked about self-care. We've talked about maybe trying to get a bit more silence in our life. I think for creative people, that's... I heard an interview with Ed Catmull, who's the president of Pixar, and one of, you know, maybe the best storytelling organization there is. And he says every year, for 1 week, he goes on a silent retreat every year. And that's Ed Catmull, you know, Mr. Successful Creative Guy. Every year he has a week of silence. And we've talked a bit about... how to deal with setbacks, which we all face in life in all sorts of ways. And so I asked myself at the end, did I succeed on this trip? And it really helped me, this trip, I think, in quite a deep way, it helped me redefine how I understood success. Because understanding success, it might mean achieving our big plan, our big goal to whatever, build our empire, whatever that is. But actually, I started to think it's more about getting up every day and doing my best, not just at work, but in every area. And that was actually a very profound and important lesson for me. And I genuinely felt much more at peace, kind of with my life as a whole, having done this expedition. So I don't have any kind of regrets. And I almost think it's better that I didn't succeed with my plan A, but I learned that lesson, than it was if I'd just, it had all gone very smoothly. So that's my question for you. Maybe that's possibly one of the most important questions in our whole lives we need to answer, is what is my definition of success? And just after I got back, right on schedule, a kind of a new realm of trying to do my best was should be a picture of my baby. I must have deleted it. Okay. imagine a beautiful baby. I've just had my time's just up. So thank you very much for your time. And shall we do? I know you want to see my babies. And then we've got 5 minutes for questions, maybe. Let's go to. Do you have any questions? If you just chat them out, yeah.
You've obviously had to set up your camera a lot of the times to get those types of shots. Did you ever want to say, sod the video and the camera, and just not bother trying to add those extra steps in?
Yeah, filming. I'm sure a lot of you are good at filming and things. It's major extra hassle to, you know, I had to set up my tripod, run back to my cart, walk past it, run back again. Kind of old school filming, and sometimes, yeah, but on the other hand, it was kind of nice to have a few projects to kind of keep me interested aside from the expedition. I've learned the hard way on other expeditions not to have too many projects. So I've done a couple of things with National Geographic where suddenly you kind of lose control of your filming, and you're given a lot of ideas, let's call it, from them about what you should be doing, and it makes it much harder. Whereas this, I'm self-funding a film to be made from this, so I'm kind of in control. So it was okay, the filming, and I'm writing a book and things. So I kind of did bits and pieces, but I didn't have any sponsors on this trip. I just self-funded it just to keep it simple. Other questions? Yeah.
Were there ever moments on the trip where you just didn't think you'd make it through, and how do you conquer, I guess, that fear?
Yeah, the question is, were the moments when I didn't think I'd make it through, and how did I conquer that fear? Yeah, I did experience, I mean, the label for it was panic. A couple of times when I was just feeling like I was getting behind schedule, or when I was getting caught and things. I think, I don't know if you've ever done I think it's called cognitive restructuring, which is where it's kind of like you name your feeling. So my feeling was panic. And then you outline, okay, then you try and sort of reason your way through it. What are the rational reasons to feel panic? I'm on my own, I'm in the desert. But then you think, what are the rational reasons not to panic? And those would be, don't panic. Those would be, I am actually on schedule, even though I feel like I'm going too slow, I'm on schedule, I know where my next car, I've got enough water. And then how do you feel after that? And I think, actually, it's not as bad as I felt. So our feelings are helpful, but we can't sort of just accept them. So I use cognitive restructuring, which is really helpful.
What do you miss the most during those 2 months?
What do I miss the most? Wow. I really missed, friends and family, Christine and community. And it felt like more than, because other expeditions I've been on, like cycling expeditions, you're always meeting people, so you're never that alone, really. Whereas this, like, even when I only had 2 weeks left, it really felt like an eternity. It was like, I don't know how I can get through these 2 weeks. So it was really hard, but it was also, I think sometimes those hard experiences are very good for us, and we shy away from them too much. Yeah?
What's the next adventure?
Next adventure, so here's my website, and do connect with me on LinkedIn and things. It would be great to stay in touch. Next adventure, I've got a couple of ideas. I'm not really ready to share them. I tend to only do a big expedition every couple of years, because I find if I think too hard, it gets a bit contrived, and I end up doing expeditions for the wrong reason. I have to find one I really am passionate about. And obviously now with a baby, it's sort of changed my attitude to risk a bit. So might be, I'd go a bit more cultural adventures, crazy. Desert. We'll see.
What sort of navigation did you take with you so you didn't get lost?
Navigation, that's one of the good things about technology on this expedition was now you can, obviously there's Google Maps, which are like zoomed in, even in the middle of the desert where no one's been, you've got like very, very detailed maps. And on I don't think you can do it on Apple phone, on iPhones, but on Android phones, there's an app, which means you can download all the Google and Bing satellite maps. So I had all the maps offline, and your phone has got, the blue dots? That's a GPS dot, that's not a mobile phone signal dot. So I still have the blue dot on my phone and satellite maps. So it was when Charles did it, he just had basically a blank map, but he knew where the river was, but other than that it was just blank. Whereas I could see even where the big dunes were, where the small dunes were, and it made a huge, I don't think I could have even attempted it without that technology. So.
And did you have a heliograph with you? A heliograph, like a mirror. So if you did get lost, and there was a search party,
Oh, a mirror. No, that would have been a good idea.
And what is for you actually to reason to make an exhibition like this by yourself and not with a team or with a partner?
The question is, why do I do this one alone, not with other people? I've done both. I've never done like big expeditions, but sometimes I've done it with one friend. And there are pros and cons. It's kind of more fun, it's less scary with a friend, but it's a different sort of test. And on your own is a very special sort of test to take on. I like kind of taking on a test. So I think this one, I kind of thought, right, it'd be cool to do a desert but on my own, like to test myself in a kind of new way of being on my own. If I'd been with a friend, it would have been less scary, but I don't think it would have been the same special experience. Great. I think time is probably up. So you've been a wonderful audience. Please stay in touch. And thank you very much.
Well, thank you so much. And thank you, everyone, for going. Our next theme is equality. So please join us next month and keep in touch. Thank you so much, Rob.